We should be so instinct, shouldn't we, about being here and receiving God's word. Amen. The message today, unanswered prayer. You can all groan just a little bit because we are all experts in that area, aren't we? One time or another in our life, there are things that we have prayed for that should have happened, could have happened, might have happened, didn't happen. And we ask, why, God, why? Well, today we're going to talk about some of those things. And we're going to talk about what Scripture has to say about prayer and how we approach it and how God responds to us during those times of prayer. I got to thinking about how we as a people in general are usually pretty upfront when we are expressing our needs or our wants, right? For instance, we tend to ask somebody, if you've got to move something heavy, can you help me move this heavy object, or can you move this heavy object for me, right? Or we might be shopping for shoes, and we might ask the clerk, do you have these shoes in a different size? Because what they have on the shelf doesn't meet our need. So we're pretty upfront in saying, I like these shoes, but do you have them in a different size? Or some of us, not all of us, and that would be a whole nother sermon topic, would ask for directions. I'm not touching it, girls. I'm not touching it. We might say, how do you get to here or there? And ask someone. We might not. We're pretty upfront. If you have children, or if you ever had children or raised children or were around children, or JoJo keeps children every day, I'll bet it's just a barrage of questions, one right after the other, many being, why, right? All right. But with children, it's a constant barrage of requests because they know what they want. Not that it's always the best for them, but they know what they want. Can I have a snack? Can I watch a video? Can I play outside? Can I stay inside? Can I stay overnight at Johnny's house or Susie's house? And then as they get older, the questions get a little more complicated. Like, can I have a phone? Or can I drive the car to the party? Or can I go to the party? The questions aren't as easy as they grow. Some of these questions, whether it's little children or older children, can be answered with a simple yes or no. And sometimes the response depends on the situation, right? Maybe different one day to another. But many of them require a lot of thought and a lot of discussion before you go into it. So the initial response might be something like this: we'll see, or later, or not now, or just silence, which usually elicits the can I, right? From little kids, or bigger kids for that matter, or husbands or wives or, yeah. Doesn't it seem at times as though God's response to our prayers is very similar? Very similar to what we give to children, whether they're young children or older children. Often God says yes or no or later or simply not now. And if we don't get the answer that we expected and wanted and desired, then there's some conflict that begins to occur from within. But the silence one, I think, is the toughest one to take, right? The not hearing anything at all, the asking, the being very clear on what your needs are, and hearing nothing but silence. And I think that that's what we really need to explore, is what do we do with that silence, those times of seemingly unanswered prayer? Well, as I mentioned earlier, we'll go to Scripture And as I look, there are a lot of scriptural responses to unanswered prayer, or to how we pray or how we approach prayer, but I don't think any of them read any better than 1 John 5. Oops, I missed something in there. 1 John 5, 14 and 15. If you want to get your Bible and read along, it's short, it's sweet. 1 John 5, 14 and 15. And it says this, "This is the confidence we have in approaching God," referring to prayer, "that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. And if we know that He hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have what we asked of Him." This is the Word of God for the people of God. So what is unanswered prayer? It's when God says no or wait. It's those prayers that we, for some reason, think that God couldn't have possibly heard because, after all, it's too good not to answer. We thought it through and stacked it all up and took it to God, and we were waiting for just the answer that we knew was the right answer, and boom, we hear a no or silence or wait. It's those prayers that we, for some reason, think that God couldn't have possibly heard. He must have been busy listening over here while we were praying over here, because after all, we didn't hear anything back. God's a busy guy, you know. And just maybe He didn't hear what it was that we were laying out to Him. It's kind of like a little kid that goes to a store, and don't you love marketing in the stores? Because the stuff for little kids, they put right down at their eye level, right? And it's always the junky, the most expensive junky stuff that there is. Or go to the cereal aisle and all the stuff that's 55% or more sugar, right at eye level for the little kids, right? All brightly colored. And the little kids, "Mom, please, Dad, can I have? I need it. I want it." And there's our response again, maybe later, not now, or silence. God, are you hearing me in my prayers? Do you hear me? Max Lucado calls unanswered prayer it. And I have to say this right because I'm quoting from Lucado. I think I've got a slide on this, Becky. On unanswered prayer. Unanswered prayer may be God's gift of protection from unintended consequences. I'll let you chew on that for a little bit. Go back to that other one there, Becky, and hold that for a while. Max Lucado calls these repetitive prayers that we keep thinking that we have to take to God over and over again because surely He didn't hear it. He calls those prayers it. And he says, it troubles, fatigues, and shames you. It is the disease unhealed, the wayward child, the untamed rage. It looms over your life. And here it comes. I can't take it anymore. It overshadows every area of your life and sometimes the lives of those around you. And it will run rampant over you until you take it to Jesus. I love that perspective. If you go back and look at that verse in John 5:13 and 14 again, and it says, pray with confidence and leave it with God. And in my prayer paraphrase version, I would say he's handling it even when we don't see any movement. Amen? Amen? Amen. Now that other slide, Becky. Whatever you face, you can face down your faith in your Heavenly Father who hears your prayers. But our hearts have to be right. If our hearts aren't right, we can be getting all kinds of answers to prayer, but we're not hearing it, we're not absorbing it, we're not taking it on. So our hearts have to be right before we can gain this kind of confidence. You see, Jesus calls us to align our hearts with God's heart. Now think about that for a minute. Jesus calls us to align our heart with God's heart. God's desire is that we want for ourselves what he wants for us. Okay, let that soak in for a minute. God's desire is that he wants us to want what he wants for us. Why? Who knows better what we need than God? Goes back to that question of how many times have you prayed for something and you didn't get the answer that you wanted, and down the road you said, oh, thank you, sweet Jesus, that I didn't get the answer that I wanted. Yeah. We have to align our hearts with God's heart. God wants our goals to be his goals. He wants us to pray, thy will be done, and mean it. He wants us to give it to him. He wants us to leave it there in confidence that he has not only heard us, but is addressing the situation even while we are still praying. Friends, our emphasis should be, as the scripture says, on God's will, not our will. Like I said a few weeks ago, and I've repeated a couple times, and I'm going to keep repeating it because I need to hear it. There's one God, and you ain't him. And neither am I, and nobody that we can see on this earth is. God's will, not our will. And when we stop praying an assorted laundry list of wants and needs and instead just converse with him on what he wants, friends, that's praying with faith and confidence, and your prayer life will change at that point. I was looking through my Joyce Meyer Bible, and she had a little quip in there that she said that she often has a very specific prayer request or a prayer need, and she takes it to God in prayer, but she always prefaces it with saying, this is what I think I want or need, and it seems like a good idea to me, but if I'm wrong in what I'm asking, Lord, please don't give it to me. Your will is what I want, not mine. There's a prayer right there. Let's face it, when we go to God in prayer, there's something we want or we know that we need, or we're praying for somebody else and something that they want or need. But if it's not God's will, it's not going to happen, right? So why don't we just give it to God from the beginning and say, God, here's what's on my heart, here's what's on my mind, but if you know that it isn't the right thing right now for me or this person, then your will be done. And then lay it down and leave it lay. Don't pick it back up, put it in your pack and carry it again. Friends, when you pray a prayer like that, giving it completely to God, that is a bold prayer. But we have to ask ourselves, do we have enough faith and confidence to pray it, or do we fear more what God might not do? want to let that soak in for a little bit? Think we should. Do we fear more of what God might not do if we give it completely to Him? After all, He needs us to give Him a very specific list of our wants and our needs and our desires, right? He doesn't know until we tell Him. So we have to be very specific. You can number them out and you could even bullet point in between. Does it change who God is and how He's going to react? No, not one iota. When we pray for God's will for our prayers, we have to remember that we are releasing it to God's timing. And until the timing is right, we are not going to see the manifestation of our answer, and it may not even come until we reach the other side. Think of that in a situation of a death. We pray for healing. We pray for comfort. We pray for peace. And we want all those things for ourselves or for the person who's ill and ailing. But the truth is, the healing may not come till the other side, right? We've seen it time and time again. But that's okay too. Because it's not about us, it's about... Well, it might be about us if we're praying for our own healing. But it's about God's perfect timing and His perfect will. We have to remember that God's will is for all to be saved. Everyone. His perfect creation. That's all of us, by the way. You may look in the mirror and disagree with that, but you know what? Every one of you is made in God's image. Isn't that a wonderful thing? As I age, I look in the mirror and think, are you kidding me? But we are made in God's image. You know, when I didn't have hair for a while, I thought it was bad, but then I look back there at John and think, there's hope. In His perfect image. And He wants everyone to be saved. So He just might use what you see as an unanswered prayer instead as a beacon of light and hope for someone else who needs spiritual healing. You may not see how He's used it, but God uses our prayer requests and our hearts, the meditations of our hearts, in mighty ways. God knows what is best for us. Anybody want to argue that? Come on up. You believe that or you wouldn't be here. You're just still trying to figure out why it is that if He knows what's best for us, my long list of wants and needs, quote unquote, doesn't get answered the way I want Him. God's not communicating with me because He knows what's best for us, but. God knows what is best for us so that our souls can grow. That's where He's concerned, is for our souls. He's a big picture God, and we are not big picture people. And aren't you glad of it? Aren't you glad you didn't know what was going to happen in Noblesville the other day? And by the way, in that, this church was touched directly with that because Martha Lovett's granddaughter, Henry's daughter, Chandy, and her husband and all five of their children are in that school district. Chandy's husband, Pat, is a principal, not in that school. Chandy works as a paraprofessional in an elementary school right next door where it happened. They have two in high school, I think, two in elementary, and one in that middle school, who was gone on a field trip that day. So when you think, well, that's down in Noblesville. Yeah. God knows what is best for us, and He's a big picture God, and we are not. In his book, Before Amen, Max Lucado reminds us that God's got this. God's got it. He's got it figured out, and he knows the end of the story. And he goes on, Lucado goes on to say, and again in a way that only he can say it, he says, if you don't believe it, think about this. God's in the Oval Office. He pulled a coin out of the mouth of a fish. He stopped waves with one word. He spoke and a tree withered. He spoke again and a basket of bread and fish became a banquet. Economy, meteorology, botany, food supply, boom, all at one time. There's how awesome our God is. And that's just to name a few. So the question is, can you have faith and confidence that such a God can and will respond to your prayers in an appropriate way in his perfect timing? And I hope your response to that is, yes, ma'am. Our gratitude to God, even for unanswered prayer, glorifies him. John 14:14 says this, ask me for anything in my name and I will do it. Well then, God, why don't my prayers get answered? But here's what it is. We pray and then we trust and glorify him for perfectly ordering our lives, not as we would want it, but as he sees fit in the bigger picture. It's one thing we know for sure, that first song we sang, Everlasting God. What is there that's everlasting? Everlasting. Anything? Anybody got a thought for that? Huh? Twinkies? They probably would, yeah. Yeah. But really, what is everlasting? What lasts forever? Life. Huh? Life? Well, true. But only when we believe in God and give ourselves to him. Then life is everlasting. Because he is an everlasting God. Thank you. Life everlasting. God will not change. The same yesterday, the same today, the same forever and ever. Amen. I don't know about you, but that makes me so happy in my heart. To know that he is the same and that he won't change in a world that has just gone stinking nuts, God is the same. So we need to ask ourselves if in our prayers we're asking him to change us or are we asking him to change to fit our desires. Ouch. God wants what's best for us, folks. And if you don't think so, look around this church and look at the wonderful things that have happened. But every time we take a giant step forward, something comes in and slam dunks us, and it's not always a good thing, right? It's our affirmation that we know that we are doing exactly what God wants us to do in his perfect timing, and Satan wanders in and says, well, just hang on here a moment. We're going to throw a little wrench in these works, but when it's God's will, it has always come to fruition. God wants what is best for you. He wants what's best for others. He wants what's best for his kingdom, which is everything and all things. Humble prayers of trust and faith and asking God's will to be done are the keys. So the question is, are you bold enough to pray and trust God for his perfect timing in your life? Are you bold enough? Because that's a pretty bold prayer. And I challenge you to that. And when you trust him for his perfect timing, even when it seems like he's not answering, do you waver or you just keep hanging on? and waiting for his perfect timing. So maybe, just maybe, today will be a new beginning in your prayer life, one of confidence and trust in God's perfect plan for your life. And I urge you once again, as I do each week, go home and study this scripture from today. It's short. I kept it really short for you for the holiday. Two little lines. Go home and study that and see what God is saying to you through that scripture. What does he want you to do? What does he want from you? What is he going to do for you? It's about as clear can be. As my grandmother used to say, clear as a bell, whatever that means. So go home and study the scripture, and my prayer for you is simple, that it hits home, that you figure it out, that you hear what he's saying, and that you heed what he wants in your life. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you again for the beautiful day, and we thank you for this scripture that, albeit short, is very challenging because we want what we want. What we want, when we want it. And we absolutely must know best, because you made us your perfect creations, and therefore, when we ask for something, we know that that's perfect timing, and we know that that's the way that it should be. But God, that's not the way that you want it to be in our lives. You want us to be in relationship with you, to trust you, to bring it to you, and then trust you for the right answer at the right time, whenever that may be. So I pray today for everyone here that they can do that. Go home, peek at that scripture off and on during the week, and then hear you speak to them about how their prayer life should be and would be, and about how much you love them. We pray it in your name. Amen. Let's stand together. We're going to close with a video. Alan Jackson, and What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear.